have two patterns for ladies' drawers. Got one from 1889 to 93, which is a lot more of a streamlined look. And I've got one from 1907. They are bifurcated drawers, which means that they are not joined up the middle. Whether I will join them up the middle or whether I won't is something to be seen. I could go either way. I have no experience with historical patterns other than the skirt I made, which is not yet finished. So select the scale corresponding to the waist measure. It is in two pieces, one half of the drawers and one half of the band. So yes, the band is cut double, so it's cut on the fold, and the drawers you do two of. Okay. These can be closed or left open. Gather the extra fullness at the top and sew to the band. So that's gathered up. Make all allowance for tucks, pin tucks. Regulate the length by the tape measure. Okay. So this 1889 pattern was reprinted in 1893, and it can be used at least as late as that date. We do not have the scale measurements for drafting this garment, so draft to the size given and then alter to fit. That's there at the website's own notes. So that's my next project, and I like the idea of having something that's a little bit longer under a skirt, because I find wearing a skirt, my legs rub together and I very easily get over warm. I think I just don't get cold very easily. And so if I'm going to be under a tweed skirt, there's a possibility that at least at some point in the day, I'm going to be a little bit too warm. And having your thighs rub underneath the skirt when you're too warm is just distinctly unpleasant. It's one of the reasons I don't wear skirts. I don't think I even possess a skirt. I have a dress. The last time I wore it was 2 years ago for an interview. So in the interest of projects and fun things to do, I've never done pin tucks. Cool. As with most historical patterns, this one gives you sort of horizontal measurements and then vertical measurements. So I start off by measuring out the horizontal measurements on two separate bits, and then do the vertical measurements from that. And then it's just a case of joining up the dots once you've got those all done, and drawing your lines. Obviously labelling your pattern. With any seams that are likely to then have to be put together, I use a piece of string just to check. Lay the string along the seam and just check that that will match up properly with the other side. Just in case, because you don't really want to make your pattern and then find that out later that it doesn't match up. Same thing with the waistband. It gives you horizontal and verticals, so and marking out the horizontals, then the verticals, and then it's just a case of matching it all up, making sure it makes sense, using the string again just to check those measurements. Drawing all your lines, and eventually cutting it all out. Of course, doing curves is a lot easier if you have French curve or some kind of curved ruler, but I don't. Double thickness of the cotton, 1.40 wide, 1.40 basically square. This is half of the waistband cut on the fold, and this is where the pattern actually ends, but I've added some room for pin tucks as well. Now, I've never done pin tucks before, so the idea is that if I add plenty of material, I then have enough to play with, and I'll probably start the pin tucks about here and then just keep going until I have the length that I want. And that's it. So I'm going to mark it up, cut it out, sew the pin tucks, do the pin tucks first, which you could do before cutting a pattern out, to be honest. If you can't be bothered to work out how much extra you need, you could just put the pin tucks into the fabric and then put the pattern on it and cut it out. I'm doing it the other way around because I can. I can't help thinking that there'll be, you know, another one sewn to it, so I'll probably cut two of those out, which means I can only get one on the fold, and then I'll have to piece the other bit together, because the pattern does not include hemming allowance here on these two, this end and this end, because you have the option in the pattern to either join the legs together completely or to leave them separate. I'm going to leave them separate because I can always join them later. And we'll just see what it looks like.
I probably could have laid this out a little bit better on the fabric. There's a lot of wastage in this, but they've kind of got to be along the grain for the legs. So if you're doing multiples, it might be easier, I suppose. But in this instance, I will use the rest of the fabric eventually. So I'm just using this off cut to get a little bit extra for the waistband, because I do want that to be two layers of fabric for the waistband. I can only imagine that that's what they intended in the first place. It wouldn't make sense with just one layer.
I'm actually quite happy that I get to practice pin tucks with these, because I do want to make a shirt with some pin tucks down the front. And this is a nice practice, because if this doesn't come off very well, well, it's underwear. There's not many people going to see it. But I've come to the conclusion that pin tucks are essentially just a massive flex for people to have in their clothing, because not only does it use up a lot more material, which in itself was valuable, it also takes up a lot of time to do each tuck. You're sewing along, you're using thread, you're using all of these resources to put a purely decorative pleat into an item of clothing. Most decorative things are a bit of a flex. It's saying, I can afford to have something purely decorative. It's not functional, it's just decorative. Anyway, I'm doing quite close pin tucks because I want to practice that again because of my shirt. So I'm doing three rows that are quite close together, and then I'll probably leave a bit of a gap and then do three, and leave a bit of a gap and do three, in a just sort of to play with it, or maybe do three and then four and then five or something like that. I haven't quite decided. I'm sat here catching Pokemon while I'm sewing, because there's an event on today. I've got a Rhyhorn that I particularly want to evolve. Right, onwards. It does take a lot of labour, because you have to measure it out, and then you iron the crisp fold into it. And then, of course, you're sewing onto that fold. So between each tuck, I'm taking the material away, ironing another tuck into it, and then coming back to the machine, sewing that. Going back to the iron, ironing another one. I've only done six, and I'm already a bit fed up of pin tucks.
These are the pin tucks I've done. I kind of ran out of room. I wanted to do three, then four, then five, then six. And what I've ended up doing is three, then four, then five, then four. So it looks a little bit odd, but you know what? I'm not angry. I'm not mad at it. I'm just finishing off with a bit of lace because, you know, I could have just hemmed it, but I think the lace actually looks quite cute on it. Look at this. I'm really loving these so far. I really do hope that they turn out quite nicely. So once I've done the lace, once I put the lace on, I will join the leg bits together so that I then have two separate legs. And then what I shall do is sew the waistband, check that that fits. If it doesn't fit, then obviously I will make a different one. And if it does fit, then I shall gather the waist and attach it to the waistband, and we shall be done. I would quite like to have like a button closure on these, but I don't know that I have any suitable buttons. Oh, I might do actually. I shall look, and depending on what I have will be what I do. It's quite a narrow hem on these, just because of the limitations of the fabric, but it seems to be going quite well on this. I think they're adorable. Now I want a petticoat that matches. I'm just going to end up with all of the clothing in the world. But as I say, I think it's quite cute.
I'm just hemming the legs now that I've joined them, each individual leg up.
Now to finish this seam off, I'm just going to go down one side and then back up the other, just to hold it down, give it a little bit more protection from fraying, because I can't be bothered to whip stitch it down, and because I think it'll look cute.
This ended up working very well actually, and I've made some more since, and I've just finished it off this way. Works out very, very nicely and stops it fraying in the wash.
One side of the drawers. There's definitely a front and back, because you can see there's a bit more room for the bum area than there is for the front area. So I need to make sure that I, or at least it feels as though there is, yes, just a slight amount. So that is one half of the legs. Done. I have the other half of the legs done as well. How adorable is that? How absolutely adorably cute is that? One half, second half, and the waistband. So now what I need to do is decide how I'm going to attach these to this, and where this thread goes. Ah, there we go. I've even done my best to match the pleats up down the middle there. I don't think I've done too badly, to be fair. For a first go, that's not bad, is it? It's quite respectable. Oh, I might just stop for dinner. Right, well, I've put the waistband on and sewn round, and now I'm just finishing it off, sewing it on fully. Just attached it in the usual way. Right sides together, one side, press it open, and then fold it over. Only the waistband is quite wide, so it's in two sections which are just joined together, and then I've top stitched over the top with the machine. I could do this by machine, but I must admit, whenever I've put waistbands on by machine, you know, finished them off by machine, they never quite look right. So I'm just finishing this off. And then I don't know how I'm going to do the closures with the centre bit. So this is the front. I've never done buttonholes by hand. To be honest, I've only ever done them by machine, and disastrously so. The legs are meant to be gathered to the waistband, but the pattern, I drafted the legs to the pattern, and the pattern was, the waistband would have been for a 30-inch waist, which I am not. I am 39 inches uncorseted, and these would go on under a corset anyway. So I drafted the legs as they were, but I did add 10 inches to the waistband, which meant that actually these legs won't gather properly. So I've just put two little pleats in right at the front, and then I have, oh, where has it gone? I have overlapped them at the back. So that's the open bit. So I've overlapped them at the back. So they overlap by that much, which really I could have gathered that along the back, which I might do if I did these again. I quite, or put a couple of pleats in, but I quite like the pleats there. So I'm just going to see how I get on with them and go from there. But for now, I'm just finishing them off, and then I shall try them on, see what kind of overlap I have, and try and work out what kind of closure I might want to put on them. Well, first time putting buttons in. Found these lovely, I think they're mother of pearl buttons. So I put those on, not terribly neatly, but I've done it. And now I'm going to have a go at doing some buttonholes. You know, I've never done buttonholes before, but they seem to be going quite well. I've done the first two, and they are a little stiff, but oh, they will loosen up. I've got very, very well waxed thread as well, so that will, oh, that one's a bit stiff. But they're matching up quite nicely. Now just need to do the third one. So I've marked where I believe it'll be.
And now it's just a case of cutting it into it. Now this bottom one's more awkward because it's where the bulk of the fabric is, around the waistband.
Oh, this one's more problematic.
And I did manage to get it there in the end. And so, simple buttonhole thread on, which is pretty easy really when you know how, and there are better tutorials out there than I can do. The actual cut of the leg itself means that you get a nice little bit of hip spring over the hips, and it just skims over and then falls down quite straight, which is very nice. So actually, I think you could gather these, but I much prefer them without the gathers, not that I've had both. I am really pleased with these. I love the way they fall. I love the length of them. It's just right. You get that lovely baggy nappy effect at the bum because they cross over. There's so much extra fabric there.
I liked it so much, I made one, two, three more. I made some amendments to the actual waistband, which I think corrected the problem of it sticking out a little bit too much. So I think they fit a lot nicer around the waist, and I still absolutely love the frilly bottoms.